Acabar.
There we go. There we go, renamed it. Smooth. Dev, you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Perfect. So I forgot the Clippers and the Heat have like zero superstars if you want to switch to the Lakers Pistons game or something.
Doesn't matter, whatever you want to do.
Sure.
All right, let's get back to this. Had to get something done. Just people pulling up at the house. This is what happens when you're getting a bunch of new stuff in. So we're back at it. Had to. It's just a lot going on over here. So I didn't want to like go over everything. Just want. All right. Here we are again. We got a special guest for you today. I'm sure you know who it is. If you looked at the title, you should know who it is. But we're going to introduce our guest formally in just a second. We just want to thank everybody for pulling up. We're going to have a little film session today. But feel free to join the discussion. Anything that you guys want to talk about with More Than Down. I'm giving away a shirt today. So all my anime fans will know, will like this one. But I'm giving away one free shirt. I'm kind of one-offed it, but I'll let you know. Give me just a second, though, before we get started. We're going to wait for everybody to get in. Shirt today. If you guys are actual real life like anime fans, see, if you know who this guy is, you're gonna get along with me very well. Ryan will know the second that he sees it. I have one for you too. So we kind of just sampled this shirt. But we didn't know if we were going to do it or not because we didn't want to get sued. You ready for it? It's the ultimate reveal right here.
Oh, I already know that. you can tell by the head.
We're giving away one of these shirts. It's our egg one.
Thank you, man.
Oh, I know why.
Oh, is it you echoing or me echoing?
Oh, I know why. It's about to stop. It's because we're getting both feeds, you know what I mean? Alright. So we should be good now. But yeah, we're giving away this bad boy right here. All right, we got a lot to go over today. I just want to welcome everybody to the In the Lab Film Sessions. Today, we have a very, very, very special guest. I watched this guy just get better throughout time, which I thought was really cool. And it just makes me happy to see his growth from early on. It makes me really happy to see his growth from early on. And he's been doing a lot better since then, since we met. We ran a camp together, and it was like crazy. It was like so many people there. Me, Ryan, and J-Law, actually. Which is funny because I didn't know who J-Law was then. I had no clue.
I'll tell you the crazy part of that story.
Hold on. We didn't even introduce you yet. I don't even have on the screen yet. Everybody give a round of applause for Ryan Rizuki.
Thank you.
We have to run up through Zoom today because our equipment was tripping. But we got Ryan with us today, and he's going to bless us up with some film, some film study, and just talking about shooting. And it's kind of going to go his way today. How you want to do it, we'll do it today. And I'll kind of piggyback off of you. So how you feel about that?
Love it.
All right.
I said we're going to do Miami and Clippers today. But considering that all their all-stars are out, we'll rock with the Lakers Pistons game.
Okay. That's fair. Let me see. Let me make sure that everybody can hear you. All right. We should be better now. All right.
So by the way, real quick, there was one kid who just one day said, I love the 10,000 hours, yada, yada, yada. I love Devin Williams, this, that, whatever. And then I just made a spur-of-the-minute decision to, like, travel to L.A. a week later when you were running a camp with Matt and your boys. So I brought five boys with me, and that's history after that.
What? That's the real story?
Yeah, some kid was just like, yeah, I love Dev. I love 10,000 hours. I went on your page, and you're hosting a camp in L.A., literally like a few days later. So I called five boys and we just drove up there, and that's how we all met.
I remember the second that you pulled up too. Mm-hmm. and then we ran the camp right after that.
Yeah, me, you, J-Law ran two of them, like, back to back.
Yeah, but like it was so many kids up there, man. You guys did a good job. I know you got a nice little group down there that you work with. Ryan has been growing down there in San Diego. You might have been seeing the videos from what his gym. What's your gym called?
My gym's called the Hoop House.
The Hoop House. You might have been. I mean, how can you not recognize it at this point? Because it's been literally everywhere. The Hoop House has been literally from Overtime to Ballers Life. We're gonna see Mikey Williams up there. Jimmy Butler. Who else has been up there?
Jazair, obviously Flight. And all them boys. So.
Yeah. So talk. Hey, wait. Hold on. Talk about this whole Flight thing. How did the Flight thing start from the jump?
When March hit and the whole pandemic started, I reached out to all the Two Hype guys, all the YouTubers, because I know that this is what they do for a living, hooping and YouTube and stuff. So I just hit them. I said, hey, if you need a gym, just let me know. If you want to work out, let me know. And Flight was the first one to get back to me.
Flight? What?
Yeah.
That's so random.
Mm-hmm.
So he lives out there?
No, he's in L.A.
So he comes all the way from L.A.?
Yeah.
That's sick. And so, when you first saw him, what was the first thing that went through your mind? Like, all right, how am I going to get him better? What does he need to work on? Like, what was the first thing that you saw?
Everything. Coordination.
He said sure. Everything.
I was like, man, it's going to be fun. He got from now until June, but we only got like four or five workouts in, so.
Since June, right?
Before June and then after June, it's only been like four or five workouts.
All right, so can you explain to me what June Flight is? Because like everybody was telling me, oh, you should play Flight. And I was like, who is Flight? I had no clue who he was. I was like, why did they call him Flight? And they told me I started dying. but I was just wondering, like, what is June Flight? Because I was like, I'm not about to just play some random guy 101. We'll do whoop.
So you know how when Cell first came out, he wasn't his final form.
Right.
So June was supposed to be like after he turned into 18, he grabbed 18. And he's in his semi-perfect form. And now apparently March It's supposed to be perfect flight form. That's the best way I can explain
is
it.
Is his hair going to turn gold like a Super Saiyan?
Yes. You don't know what's under the do-rag.
That's sick. All right. So who are we going over today? I'm going to find the film right now.
Yeah, Lakers Pistons, man. They took this. What's his second road loss?
They lost to the Pistons yesterday.
Sheesh.
I have a question for you that I'm going to ask about KCP when we get going. Okay. But for those of you guys that just kind of tune in, make sure you give a thumbs up. You thumbs up on the video and make absolute sure to follow R2Bball. R2Bball, like I said, man, he's just been growing really big and, blowing up on Instagram, blowing up on YouTube, blowing up everywhere, man, playing one-on-ones with this person, that person. And, we kind of always, had a lot of fun playing basketball together. And, when we met, it just kind of instantly hit it off. It was Smash Bros and anime and, everything. Hold on. Before you jump in, I just got the film. What's your favorite anime? I'm putting you on the spot here. Give me your top five.
I would say Hunter is number one.
Hunter is number one.
Yeah. Okay. Dragon Ball Z is only nostalgic. Okay. But if I watch it now, I wouldn't. Naruto, Hunter, Death Note, Demon Slayer might be up there.
Demon Slayer, okay.
And then there's so many. Promised Neverland is good. Erased is good. I can go on and on.
Fair is fair. Okay. We'll leave it at that, though, because we might start an argument in the comment section. So we're going to jump to the film here. So just talk us through it. Let us know everything that you see from shooting to plays. And, a lot of people don't know that, Ryan has a very high understanding of the game, watches a lot of film and basketball in general, and I trust him. I even learned some stuff from him, so it's always pretty good, and somebody that I trust.
I love it, man.
Now slow down and rewind or whatever you need me to do. Yeah, just let me know.
No doubt. What is this, fourth quarter right now?
This is first quarter.
I'm seeing fourth quarter.
It's definitely the fourth quarter with like 1 minute left. So,
you took me straight to the end of the game.
Player, period. All right, shit. Yeah, we're good now.
There we go.
All right, shit. Let's get it.
So from the last breakdowns you had, what are you seeing from the Lakers that you like and you don't like?
From the Lakers that I like, I love their chemistry. They have really good chemistry. They don't have great rim protection, which they had last year. They're very unselfish. They have guys that can knock down shots. What else do I really like about the Lakers? LeBron James is playing great. Even though he missed that, Kuz is finding his spot. I love the chemistry that is low-key, but that Gasol and have together. Gasol and LeBron James. Love the way that
first play.
Huh?
You want to go back to that first play?
Which one? The absolute first?
Yeah, absolute first one.
Okay, I'm going to jump back. Boom. But, they're a good team. They're the best team in the NBA right now.
No doubt. Not this one. It's the one after, but you'll see it. So, obviously, I love the chemistry. You talk about the rim protection. Schroeder's fitting in nicely where I was with you, but you look at some action like this, and you look how Gasol just can't switch.
There's no way, bro. So he has to play drop protection pretty much.
It's the worst defensive protection is drop.
And whereas in the past they have been able to pretty much almost switch anything. Even, JaVale McGee, they would trust him to guard some guys on the wing just because he's longer and he's not slow-footed or anything.
At least hedge and poke it.
Right. Straight up.
You're right. We talked about the Nets possibly running some zone.
Mm-hmm.
What you see the Lakers doing in the playoffs if Gasol's a liability on defense?
I just don't see them playing them that much. Mm-hmm. They did it last year where they wouldn't play JaVale for a whole series, or they wouldn't play Dwight for the whole series. Then they play against Denver and they put him in initially. He's getting playing time and effective the game. I remember, I'm talking about Dwight Howard right now, but did a great job at affecting the game.
Yeah. Talking to some, when I talked to Johnny a lot, he was playing the Hornets. That's hard on your mental to just sit out an entire game.
It is. 100%. And so, and it's hard to get back in the swing of things when it's like that. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Move you up. But you and I were on the same boat when we said losing Rondo was a loss. Like, it hurt us. But Schroeder's playing pretty well.
Schroeder is playing very well. But in my opinion, he's still not Rondo. Rondo was so valuable to this team, in my opinion. But, you know, you can't get mad at a guy that nobody can guard. Like, nobody can guard Schroeder at all. He's just too fast for him.
He's super nice. So what actions are you seeing that you like from the Lakers? Obviously, they're running a lot of different sets. You know, some step up in early action. But what do you like from them?
You know what? They've been running some flex. And they run it really well when it's LeBron James and AD involved. And so, like, you know, especially when he's doing the flex cut, AD's coming across. They had, like, almost what would have been a game winner against Philly the other night. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes when LeBron is a guy, you know, in that position to take the flex cut, he'll just shoot up the gap towards the elbow and make a play off of that. So it's like I've been actually seeing a lot of good stuff from their horn sets. They don't run it too often as much as I would like to see, but, you know, they got some. I think Frank Vogel's a really good coach, personally.
They run it back three plays. To the three-pointer that just went in.
One, two, three.
One more.
Four.
There we go. I love this action. So you see Duncan Robinson do stuff like this all the time. Mm-hmm. You see it. It's coming up, I believe. This is the one. It's a pass, a chase. Oh, might have been after this. It was a really nice one.
Was it from Detroit?
Yes. All right, I might have gone one short. It was a pass, a chase. The dude cheats and he comes back. It's some all shooters need.
Is it this one?
We'll find it. It was on the left wing.
Okay. Let's see it.
It's right here. Boom, boom, shot. Mm.
Talk about the footwork needed to take a shot like that.
Oops,
I went too far back.
You're good. Let's go back. I just love the way that he rode the dude into the screen, mm-hmm. and then made a quick read to come right back and shot it. Because Kuz was not in the right defensive stance for someone to come back off the screen twice.
What was it? The one where Blake Griffin was in the post?
Yeah, that's the one.
Where is it? I don't know why I can't find it anymore. Was it after this play? Tripping. Oh, there it is. There it is. Passes it out.
This is a beautiful action right here between the two. He fakes it, comes back. Look how smooth that is.
Got rid of him right there. Got a question for you. Hey, Ryan, I was wondering, how long did it take for you to shoot with weak dominant hand? And is it worth shooting with both hands in game?
I would never suggest it, but it took me 4 to 6 months.
4 to 6 months.
Yeah. Four months to like feel really good, 6 months to be good.
And so what? How did you end up changing all that and fixing that?
Literally just form shots. That's the only thing I did. And then once it felt good after 4 months, then I started adding dribbles and range.
And here's my question to you. So can anybody learn to shoot?
Literally anybody. There is one thing that makes it harder. Actually, I was listening to PJF and Drew Hanlon. They just had a podcast. Mm-hmm. They're talking about Semi Olaje. I think that's his name. Okay, so Semi. So what's crazy is, and you show me right now, and obviously anybody who's watching this, they can see this for themselves. My wrist flexibility is amazing. Like, I can touch my middle finger to my shoulder with my wrist pointed straight like this. So it makes it real easy for me to have my hand under the ball. Left hand is almost the same. I know some people whose thumb can't even touch their shoulder, so their wrist is pointed like this. So that already makes it hard.
So what is the main point of being able to have your wrist cocked like that?
Flexibility. But when you look at a dude like Curry, he doesn't start with his hands like this. He starts with his hands a little more like this on the side, and then it rotates on the way up. Mm-hmm.
Which is interesting because it's just like, it almost goes to show there's really no one way to shoot, but there are a lot of ways that work and ways that work very consistently.
Mm-hmm. As long as you can finish with tons of consistency.
So I like to use this example because it's so interesting to me. So Steph versus Clay, okay. And I'm gonna ask you, what are the, because they shoot different. They shoot differently. Yeah. So what would you say are the differences in a shot like that? In their shots,
Clay has a higher set point, mm-hmm. and obviously his wrist is more cocked. It's more simple motion, and he's not using any offhand involvement. The only difference is Curry's is slightly lower, but it's actually not that low. People think he shoots like from the chin.
It's not though. It's actually fairly high. Like
yeah, but Clay's a little higher. And then, like I said, Curry's got the rotation in the palm, mm-hmm. and then and I don't even know if it's a flick, but he just kind of like tucks his thumb in.
Who shot? This is always I like asking people this: whose shot would you teach, Curry's or Clay?
Clay's all day.
Why is that?
For Curry to get off some of the shots that he gets off, he shoots it at lightning speed, and he has to be able to create a ton of space off the bounce. Clay doesn't need as much space.
I agree.
And Curry doesn't need as much space because he gets it off so fast, but it's hard to be consistent at that speed.
Why?
Why is it hard to be consistent at that speed? I feel like people lose control when they're going that fast.
Me too. I agree with that. And you guys, don't hesitate to ask any questions in here. While we got Ryan, let's take advantage of this time. You know, he's training a lot of pros and real top high school players, college guys, just players from all over the world. And so, you know, come to him and you know, looking for this shooting advice. And how many guys are you working with on Zoom and, you know, that come to your facility, you're saying?
We train 250 at the facility and 40 on Zoom.
Sick. And which is crazy, especially during this times, like you're able to, you know, help so many people that need it. And this is such a good time to get better. Just in basketball in general, you know what I mean? Being that we have time. You have plenty of time to recover. You have plenty of time to work on your game. You're already at home, so there's no commute. You don't have to, like, go to school and, you know, all this other stuff. So, if you have a court, it's all you really need, right?
Yeah, go back one play where Caruso gets the inbound out of this lob right here. So you watch something like this. Pause it right here. I don't know about you, but usually off a zipper, you're getting that that pick and roll right
pick
there.
Pick and roll, right? Yep.
Right? So
that's what he's pointing to, right?
Yeah, that's what he wants. It should have been there already. But when he comes to set this pick, this is something I see a lot of youth kids mess up on. So you see Rose fight over, and the dude still is helping.
So which one?
You know who's right here, 40.
45, yep.
Right, I might be mistaken. Go back a step. Right. Oh, you're good. All right. Who's this setting the screen? Am I tripping?
Morris.
Okay. So Morris sets the screen. And right now, I want Caruso to throw that either in the pocket or over the top.
Okay. And for those who don't know, what is the pocket?
Between Rose and who's defending?
I can't. I don't know who this guy is.
Okay. But in that pocket, if Morris would have short rolled to the nail,
right.
Then yeah, or you know, between the, I don't know what that dead space, the high school 3-point line.
Right.
That'd have been fine. But if not, you can get it over the top. Or you see James Harden go behind the back and Curry go behind the back on that pass.
Yep. Absolutely.
But a lot of players don't look back after the screen.
Which is so important.
Yeah. But this is where you're talking about flex action. So if you go back even more, you look at the bottom and you look at the block.
Right there?
Right there. You see the cross screen.
Yep, there it is.
Getting Harrell on the block.
Eliminated.
So when you throw it to the block, what do you like better, Laker cut or split action? Because this is stuff that
split action every time.
So would you rather, like, you see how the Lakers overloaded all to the left?
Who's guarding Caruso right now?
Well, nobody.
Wait, who's
he tried to switch back?
Oh, the guy all the way at the end didn't switch. Okay, got it.
It was like a double miscommunication.
Okay, you asked about the split action. Why?
I love split action because you see a lot of teams will throw it into the post. And look at this. The Lakers just overload the right side.
Right.
Whereas I would rather throw it in split action with Caruso.
And so I'm a huge action of a split action because of the Golden State Warriors.
Yes.
Who run it every game. And the guys, you know, it's crazy. Like, they're NBA players that don't know how to run the split action. They don't know what to look for. And it creates so many open opportunities. And I was just, it blows me away that more teams don't do it. And it works so well with Klay and Steph because they can shoot. And then, you know,
explain to them what a split action is.
All right. So essentially it's just a down screen, but it's not. So there's ways. Or if I pass it into the post, let me see. They don't even have the set here.
No.
Okay. Actually, I mean, technically you could. Technically you could right here. So say if LeBron would go set the screen on Rose, either Caruso can go back door and then LeBron will pop out, or it can be vice versa. There's a lot of different things that you can run from it. But if you set that screen, if LeBron gets Rose topside and they end up switching, LeBron will have a wide open layup at the basket if you flash to it. So that's kind of the split action. Anything you want to add to that, Ron?
Yeah, I mean, if you have good spacing, normally where you kind of see it is like wings and corners, and you kind of got this triangle to the post.
Mm-hmm.
So the ball's in the post. Whoever throws it in, the wing and the corner will screen for each other. And like Dev said, you got to curl to the basket. This guy can backdoor, or they're both open for three. But ain't no way that someone's not open. And you're distracting two defenders who now can't help in the post.
I actually would want to. You want to show it? I could bring up some good film on that right now.
Yeah.
All right. So we'll go. This is what I'll do. Go out here. I'll go to Synergy so you guys can see what I'm doing.
You can go to Warriors.
Yeah, let's go to like 2015-16. Let's try this. We could just look up Draymond's assist pretty much.
I actually see a great comment. Let's find split action first, then I got some I want to address.
All right, Lakers, we'll do Golden State. No. We'll do team. And then we'll go 2017. And then we'll go to State Warriors. This will be good stuff for you guys to see out there, split action. So where should I do cut? It should be cut, right?
If you go to post-ups.
Post-ups.
And then passes out of the post, because you can see like assists out of there.
Or you can see
just post-ups in general. And if they score, you can still see the split action.
All right, where should I go from here? Huh. Shot attempts, half court. You know what we'll do? It's just include the passes from the post, right? There we go. Mm-hmm. And then we'll go pick and roll. Nope. Which one should we do? It's one of these. I know it is.
Post up.
Let's try this. Should be this.
Honestly, if you go to any Golden State post up possession,
because they don't score in the post really. Oh, it's going to show a bunch of this, isn't it? Let's see.
There you go.
Is it going to show Kevin Durant scoring in there?
Look how smooth the movement is.
Oh, shoot.
Take a step back.
Okay. I think I should just go to cut, because that's what I think I saw most of them from. This is going to show us.
Is it a post-up?
No, hold on. I'm almost positive it'll be cut.
All right.
Let me see.
While you're finding that, let me address this one question. So,
go for it.
One a lot. So someone said one motion or two motion, right? And you asked me what I choose.
Ah, great steps. Question.
Okay. So I say both. I made a video on this like years ago, and I told a buddy about it, and he made a video about it, and it went viral. So I never got credit for it.
What video was that?
His name is Scott Shot.
Oh, okay.
I don't think he makes any more videos. So I was like, I was telling him, don't you think everybody should have two different jump shots? And he was like, what are you talking about? Everyone needs to shoot the same way every time. I was like, yeah. This will be the same every time.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're shooting like a mid-range pull-up, no way you can carry the momentum of a one-motion jump shot.
It's just too weird. Like...
you don't throw it at the backboard. You need to lift a little more, you know, slow down on it and get it off. You know, maybe sometimes you got to elevate. But if you're shooting like a speed stop or a step back or something that's getting you away from the basket,
mm-hmm.
that's way easier to get it off, one motion, super fluid, And he's like, oh, that kind of makes sense.
They made a video about it?
Yeah.
All right, so this is what I want to do. Let's just go over their film in general, because it's a lot of stuff that you could use as a shooter, you could use and learn from this.
Look at that pocket. There it is. There's the pocket.
That's the pocket you were talking about.
Yes.
But the spacing is a lot better than what we saw from the other one, though.
Because he short rolled.
Right. And obviously, the lob comes right there. Mm-hmm. We're going to get a lot of good stuff that people to learn from. You'll get a lot of this stuff, too, from Utah. Utah's got some really, really good action that they run. All right, let's see what we get from here.
Yep, there's that pocket. That's just looking back.
Tough.
So these are all cuts, right?
Yep, everything. Yep. So you better show a lot. We'll be able to get some. Matter of fact, we should just go to. There's a lot of stuff we can do. There's a you pocket.
Talk about this stuff all day.
I know, right?
Okay, so go back to that one.
That was tough.
Okay, and freeze. Okay, so you're going too fast. All right.
Right
slow
there.
Down, real slow. Freeze. Okay. Is that Paul Millsap? Or who is that on the right? Left. Elbow.
I want to say that's Paul Millsap, but I'm not sure, though.
Okay. So he's what's called the tag man.
Wait, Paul Millsap plays for Denver, doesn't he?
Bro, I don't know who that is, but it looks like Paul Millsap to me.
Okay, we'll leave it at that.
I can't see his number either.
All right,
but the dude ahead. On the elbow, the only guy on the elbow. All right, so you got Rudy in drop coverage. You got George Hill fighting over screen. And then the big is going to roll. So when the big rolls, the guy on the weak side is having to come over and help. So, Zaza rolling. Okay. So there's the help right in the middle. Now, who's wide open all the way on the other side?
Iguodala.
Yeah. And so, like, when you come off a screen, I always teach my players, look to score, look for your screener, and then look for the tag. Because right now, Steph should be looking to score. Obviously, he can't right now.
That and what's the tag? Let everybody know what the tag is.
And the tag is the dude right there in help. At the free throw line, and Andre Iguodala is wide open. If he could throw a hook pass, obviously he's pressured, but
that was good defense too by Gobert. Yeah. Ended up falling short right there. The guy you call him Millsap.
I'm looking at the comments. No one knows.
Oh, Sheldon Mack. Sheldon Mack.
His favors. Oh, there we go. Sheldon. I knew it wasn't Millsap. I didn't know who it was.
I was like, wait a minute. Something's not right here.
But you get the idea.
It was one of those guys. It just runs such good offense, man. It really made you appreciate that. What I'm going to do, too. Let's go ahead. Some people don't value a guy like Draymond, right? Would you say that people don't value Draymond?
I would say that Draymond Green is the greatest glue guy to ever play basketball.
Yeah, who's next on that list, though?
Of a glue guy?
Yeah.
Andre Iguodala could be one now.
Okay, fair. Who else? Give me somebody else. Like a really, the best one you could think of.
I was going to say Jay Crowder, but he's still more 3-and-D. I'm trying to think of like an undersized 4. Those are usually the guys that are like glue guys. Montrez count? He's not really a scorer.
I guess. I wouldn't count Montrez.
He does a little bit of everything.
Is Scottie Pippen a glue guy? Dennis Rodman a glue guy?
It's hard. I consider Draymond a glue guy because he's not an all-star by himself. But he makes everyone around him so much better.
All right, so Steph, break it down for me.
Look at his hand. See what I'm talking about?
Yeah, you can see it. You can see how he's catching it too.
Yeah, he catches with his hands on the side of the ball. And then as it goes up, his right hand rotates, but it's perfectly under at the end. It's just so fluid. Actually, watch that again in slow-mo like you did. All right here. So you can see how his, like when the ball is down.
Oh, you can see him rotating it.
Huh?
You can see him. I saw him rotating his hand big time.
But you see one thing he does so well is he catches the ball and his hips move in such perfect alignment with the ball. So if you want to watch it again, like he catches it about the chest area. He drops with the ball, hips low, and then ball goes up and hips rise together. That's one of the most common things I see when shooting. People will do it the opposite direction. So they'll have the ball go up with their hips going down.
Okay, so what kind of action we have over here with Bogut and I believe Curry?
That wide pin down?
Yep. And so talk about the keys of coming off of this and be able to knock down the shot.
Actually, the way he set his feet like that was tough.
And why is that?
The biggest thing is how you read it and understanding it, whether to curl, pop, or flare, mm-hmm. right? So Bogut sets a good screen. He comes off it, and he just lands off a hop like that. Why I say it was difficult is because when you see the way his feet like went forward, but his body momentum didn't.
Mm-hmm.
So when you talk about core strength, he has great balance. And that's the number one thing when you're going away from the basket is to have that balance and then transfer all of your energy to the basket.
It's like perfect balance. So like, all right, here's a question I always like to hear, always like to know from other people what they think. Most of the time when you're going right into a shot, your body ends up turning, right? Yes. More so than you would just do catch and shoot. Now, why is that?
Because you're trying to align the right shoulder. And so if you watch it, he shoots it pretty straight. So like on the release, see, he's straight up and down. He just shot it. And then the turn happens afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
So not on the actual shot. Because if you see the release, he's still pointed at the rim, still pointed. And now he turns. So that's just a product of momentum.
Okay. Let's keep going down the Golden State line. It's been a long time. Oh.
That was some of the most beautiful action
I've ever seen. This is nasty, bro. let's go over it.
You get a double pin down and just the gravity that Steph has.
Did you see the route that he took, though? Look at his route that he took.
Yeah, he went inside.
Yeah, he went inside the guy right here. That's just Sean Livingston, right?
Him and didn't Allen Iverson do it a ton?
Yeah, technically Iverson did do that. I don't remember it as often though, but like this is
Reggie,
pretty.
Sorry, Reggie.
Yeah,
Reggie,
okay, Reggie a little Reggie, different. Reggie. But this is different though because he followed him that way too, and it made him completely open. He actually pretty much set a screen, which left Livingston wide open. And that's his patented jump hook.
People forget that when you set a screen, you're normally going to be more open than anybody.
Have you seen how players use the defense as a screen to screen their man? Like Curry's like infamous for doing. Have you seen people do that yet?
You're talking about like it's like jamming it but reverse?
Yeah, so like basically they'll do it in transition and they'll use like the big from another team to screen their man. They'll just run at him. It's like it's really interesting to see it.
Oh yeah. I know exactly what you're talking about.
So talk about this action. So what is Bogut's first? Normally what is Bogut going to do on these type of plays?
He's going to go set a pin down for Klay.
So what opens this dunk up?
Zebo's trying to communicate because Klay has so much gravity. You can't let Klay shoot it.
Sometimes terminology, what would you say how important terminology is?
Super.
And why?
I think it's actually super important just to get everybody on the same page. And then understand what you're doing.
Right.
So when I do my training sessions, we always focus on a skill, right?
Right.
Say that the skill is, let's say the skill today is Euro steps. And then what I'll do is I'll have my players do some sort of action prior to catching. Because when you watch basketball, obviously, all these guys, before they catch the ball, they're typically doing some sort of lift, drift, pick and pop, popping out off a narrow pin down, filling open space. Some of the sort, or you're setting a screen. So I always have my guys do something like that before they catch it and rip and get into the Euro step.
Right.
Because you'll be able to see those things a lot easier.
So real quick, I want to talk about, I see you and Mikey Williams a lot. Oh, there it is. So
we got a split action?
Yeah, I don't know why it took me so long to find that. They ended up both doing the same thing. I mean, it wasn't a perfect split action, but ended up.
Yeah, weird spacing. Well, they both cut.
So how did that open up? What would you say? What set that up?
Let's take a look. I mean, obviously you got Steph screening for Clay, so that already leads for disaster. There was a huge miscommunication. Who's number four?
I don't even know anymore.
He was trying to tell him that the screen was coming, and I don't know if he wanted to switch or what he wanted, but the dude took so long to get through.
What was he doing? I think he just kind of messed up too.
He was at fault. Number one's at fault. He's the one who didn't know what he was doing. He didn't fight through it. He didn't switch it. And then they were both open.
And it was really weird because they both like ran to the basket.
Someone said, finally split action. I know.
I don't know why it took me so long to find. I know we can find these like super fast.
What were you saying about Mikey?
Oh yeah, so Mikey. So what? How did you guys get connected? Because I seen them playing, you know, looking pretty good lately. What would you say about them?
Dude, I have so much faith in him because he works nonstop. That's the number one attribute that he has, and why it's not his jumping ability, it's not his tenacity. None of those things matter to me as much as his work ethic.
And so for him, when he got in the gym with you, talk about like, okay, what's the first thing that we need to get going? Like we need to work on? What's some of his weaknesses and, you know, just little things? And then also what are you going to need to do in order to get better? Because he's already like crazy bouncy, you know what I mean? Like, what do we need to do?
His jump shot still needs improvement. He shoots it well, but just can shoot do it with more consistency. Mm-hmm. The biggest thing, when he came in, he said he wanted to work on his handle a lot. So we put him through a lot of game action, having, you know, single, double team, you know, high pressure, coming off ball screens, going downhill, things like that. And when we talked, you know, some days he would, because, you know, he did a lot of live work. He loves to go live. And so I would tell him, okay, I need you to score in this type of way or this type of way. So some days he was working just on his pull-up jumper, mm-hmm. limited dribbles. And other days he would spaz the out of the ball, you know, and like even if he beat you, he'd like bone collector, snatch it back and try again.
he's doing that type of stuff, huh?
Yeah. And so I'd be like, oh, Mikey, that's too much. But he has a really good understanding and saying like, I could score, you know, normally I'm trying to work on my handle. So that was cool to see that level of intellect from him. Mm-hmm. And then there would be some days where he'd be working literally on just drawing fouls.
And how would he work on that?
Like once he had you beat, he would pump. And if you jumped, he'd jump into you. Or he'd pump once and then pump twice and just like cope and jump into you. And so it was kind of cool to see him like every single day know what he's trying to work on.
So yesterday we had a really good game with Dame Lillard and John Wall playing against each other. It was like kind of a fun game to watch. I was calling it on TNT, and I saw John Wall take the most threes that I've ever seen him take ever. And he was just kind of maybe not ever, but he was gunning them up. And I never like thought that I would see that. So let's take a look at his jumper, Dame Lillard's jumper, and just tell me what you're seeing out there. We're going to get a bunch. I'll just line them up. And also, Gary Trent Jr. is another guy that's been knocking down shots, too.
I love looking at both these jump shots here. So, Dame's, some people now know this, but not enough people. I think I told you this, that Dame's fingertips actually come off the ball mm-hmm. before he shoots it, which is insane. But regardless of that, his fluidity is A++++. I mean, look at that. He's got a mid-range pull-up. He's got a step back. He's able to get off any shot.
What makes his jumper able to go in at such a high rate? What would you say? And then, no. Better question. How is he able to shoot from so deep?
His hips, and he's got a great snap. But his fluidity, like I said, is the thing that's A++++++, and that's one of the hardest things to change or fix for a player.
All right, so John Wall's jumper. We got a chance to see it right there. What do you think? Hold on. Before you go over that, somebody said, hey, Dev, is there any chance of the OG Equalizer shoes being available in 11.5? Unfortunately, I wasn't able to financially afford them at the time of release and would love to buy a pair. Unfortunately, we got to wait on China, and then, you know, the whole COVID thing is slowing it down, so we don't have any of the first ones, but if we do, like, I'll make sure I post about it. Make sure you lock in on Instagram or whatever, just to be, you know, stay tuned when we're going to get those shoes. But Right now, we don't have any. I wish we did, because I love those shoes, and mine kind of went bad. But yeah, let's talk about John Wall's jumper.
Somebody actually brought up a good point I forgot to talk about earlier. When I mentioned how you have to have two different jump shots, your set points change. So if I'm shooting like Kawhi in a 10-foot pull-up, I'm going to have a really, really high set point to get
higher release, yeah.
But if you're like Dame and you're shooting from 30 feet out, you're going to have a lower set point. And so then it'll fluctuate the closer and farther you are. So he does a good job of knowing. Like if you watch his, go back to his mid-range pull-up, you'll see it above his head, but you'll see him shoot the 30-footer and it won't be.
I think this is a play right here.
This one right here.
Yeah, that was high. Yeah,
his set point is above his head.
Yep.
It's all the way up there. That's not normal for him. But for a pull-up, yeah. And then if we find one of his 30-footers, you'll see it much lower than that. And so it's a lot about his rhythm.
So how would you teach a player to have two different ones?
It's not. It's on a scale. So I wouldn't teach it, really. It's something that becomes natural when you build correct fluidity. Because you've never thought about raising or lowering your set point.
Nope.
But you'll do it if someone's contesting you or if you're from really far away.
Now, what about John Wall's jumper? What does he need to do, or has he fixed up on the jumper that, that he once struggled with? I would definitely say last stuff we saw of him, he kind of struggled with shooting from deep, but mid-range, it was always really good.
Fluidity. It's actually not bad, but it's not as, it's not like a waterfall. You know, it's more like honey, slower.
Just takes too long to get off or what?
I watched him shoot a three. It's not about just how long it takes, but it's just about connecting the hips. And so they go up at the right time. It's just slow as they move. So it's harder to build that range, but that's why his mid-range is so much better.
Did you teach yourself how to shoot?
I mean, my left hand, yeah.
And then who taught you how to shoot with your right?
I just watched Kobe, and then I went to a few basketball camps, and they just said, put your hand under and just shoot it.
Chuck. that was pretty much it. check this one out. So this is off the dribble, and just walk us through what you see.
Perfect. Yeah, I don't know, man. It's weird. No one taught me anything crazy. They just said, put your hands here and shoot the ball. So if you look at this one, his set point is still pretty high, but it's way lower than the other one. It's right about his forehead, about ball's about halfway up.
And why? Why though? I wonder. That's what I don't know. I want to know why you think is at this point it's high still.
Why it's still high?
Yeah. Why is it still high at this point?
I wouldn't consider that high.
Okay, so you said the other one was higher.
Yeah, way higher.
Got it.
Would you consider forehead high?
No, absolutely not. And then when he shoots deep, does he shoot lower than that, or does he shoot about the same?
It gets a little lower.
Got it. But regardless, his hand is still under the ball.
Always. Right. Dame is so good off different footworks too. So when you watch that last one, they switch cameras, but he can pop into it off a hop, and he can go off a 1-2.
It's crazy where these dudes can shoot now, man. like that in the middle of an NBA basketball game, they pull up from the end, like H-Town. Like, that's crazy to me. Like, I never thought about shooting from that deep when I played personally. It wasn't really a thing. He's about to shoot that.
So if you split the ball in half, the last one, half the ball was above his forehead. Now you split the ball in half. It's almost that high too, but it is a little bit lower. I'd say the bottom's touching his eyebrow.
The bottom's up, okay.
Still pretty high though.
I know, and it's kind of surprising, right?
Yeah.
Do you think that these guys think about that though? Like when it's time to shoot?
Absolutely not.
All right, walk me through this whole, let's watch the play and then you can run us back through everything.
Cool. Okay. That's a Duke cut, am I wrong?
Honestly, I don't know what a Duke cut is.
Beautiful.
Terminology.
If you start it, it might be different. What do you call this one? Go back to it. 56. It's like a UCLA cut, but instead of going to the basket, he goes to the corner.
Oh, so like you're talking about if we're at Horns. So you call that a Duke cut, right?
What do you call it?
Let me see.
He came off of UCLA, but instead of going to the basket, he went out to the corner.
And you're talking about the guy at the top. Who is that? Derrick Jones?
Yes.
Well, he has his back screen, so you just come off of it. Actually, that is like similar to a UCLA cut, right?
Yeah.
So so educate me. What would you call a Duke cut?
What would I call? I'd call it a Duke cut. But it's
so
like
exactly what he did, right?
Yeah. I mean, that's what I would call it, where you kind of go through like a UCLA, but go to the strong side corner. That's what I was taught.
Okay. And then from there.
Okay. I want to see this dribble here. Let it play out.
Okay, cool.
Okay, so I actually love this. Go back to it. And you got to play this in real slow motion or as much as you can.
Okay.
So you see Kawhi Leonard's game winner.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay, the one that rattled in.
Yeah.
So he did something that a lot of people are kind of unaware of. So if you watch Dame, normally you take a dribble and you take about two steps between it. Right? Especially if you're dribble 1-2. But you watch his last dribble. I don't think it's this one. I think it's the next one. And he goes dribble 1-2-3-4.
I got what you're saying.
To get into the rhythm, chasing after the ball, and pop into the shot right at the line. And then you see how he hangs more on this one? And this is more a two-motion shot because his momentum is carrying him so much.
To the right.
Yeah.
Got it.
So I would suggest that I think he did it right.
You would suggest that he did it right, you said?
I think he did it right on this one.
Gotcha. I just want to see, what would John Wall and Rose and Morant and all these athletic guards, Russell, what would they look like if they were able to really shoot from deep, like a Dame, like a Steph? Like, when are we going to – what's the closest combination that we've seen to, like, from really athletic Mitchell? To that could really shoot?
Mitchell.
I like that. And I agree. I agree 100%. And so for me, I would say Mitchell. I'll say Murray, because Murray's actually pretty athletic. And so, he's not as athletic as all the guys I just named, but, you know, he'll get up and dunk on you too and have some really athletic plays at the rim. So that's okay. I like that.
They exist.
I like that. All right, so his mid-range, let me know.
That's his bread and butter.
High release, lower release?
Let's take a look at it. Good. It's actually about his eyebrow, but he didn't have any arc on the shot. So on the release, it pushed out instead of up.
So you're fixing that by saying put more arc on it, right?
On that specific shot.
All right. So what do you teach players in these situations? You see, he got the ball taken right there.
Never to rock the ball ever.
And rocking, you mean by rocking by what?
Never rock the ball side to side.
Right.
You either got to tuck it or hold it over the top or low or something different.
Who do you have as the best point guard? I'm sorry. Yeah, the best point guard in the NBA right now.
Steph.
All right, so after that, who you got? Give me like your top four, top five.
Steph. Does Harden count as a point guard?
I count Harden as a point guard, but a lot of people don't like to.
Okay, Steph, Harden, and then you could go with Kyrie or Dame.
Kyrie or Dame?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Who do you got?
No. I'm with that. I'm fine with that.
Who would be your next?
I don't know. Luka got to be in there somewhere, right? I don't know. I struggle with this every day. I have no clue. All right. Somebody says, I work out twice a day and watch film. Daily tips for D1. You got any daily tips for a D1 or a guy pursuing D1?
Yeah, he's doing all the right things. Just make sure that you're not just working out hard, but you're working out smart, that you're actually improving.
And the schedule for a guy like, okay, clearly Mikey's got a shot at being in the NBA, right? Mm-hmm. So schedule that you try to keep him on.
Obviously depending on games and stuff, but he would work out twice a day with me, and then I'd send him to my cryo person, and then sometimes he'd run hills. And then I always wanted to have a lighter day, but he didn't want one.
His release is low on this, right? Was his release low on that? Hold on.
See it.
My fault, I didn't mean to interrupt you right there, but.
No, no, you're good. You're good. No.
Like, lower, it was a lot lower than what he had him on those pull-up jumpers.
It's about the same, but there's no rhythm into it.
Huh?
It's less rhythm in a free throw.
Right.
Because you're just all by yourself, relaxed.
I just think it's really funny to look at all these different guys' jumpers, because then you got a guy like Trae Young who 100% has a lower release. Dang, look at that.
Yeah.
It's like easy out there, too.
The rhythm is amazing.
That was
low. That's a low one. Yep. There you go.
That was lower.
A lot of people saying CP3 in the conversation. Oh, and Ice Trae? I wouldn't put Ice Trae as top PGs in the league yet.
Trae Young?
I wouldn't put him top.
No, me yet. Either. Me yeah. either. Not yet.
My bad for forgetting about CP. I love CP.
As a top point guard?
No. Yes.
So you got him like in the fifth spot then, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Tough, bro. It's too hard to come up with. Because is he the same point guard that he once was? So somebody said, okay, let me look. Let me see what people have. Curry, Harden, Kyrie.
The playoffs, right?
So wait. If Harden's not a, and I like asking people this question to see their response. If Harden's a point guard, then what is LeBron?
You're asking me?
Yeah, what is LeBron? Because we only have five positions. Like, there's only five positions. There's point guard, forward. Shoot. No, but there's no. That's not a thing. It's not on like. It's not on the list. It's actually a point guard, shooting guard, power forward, small forward, center. Like.
He's a playmaking small forward.
Okay, all right.
But you could call him a point guard.
I always like to ask people just to see what they're going to say.
Someone said, "Is Kyrie the best offensive player?"
Well, you know what? This is what we're going to do then.
You going to pull it up?
I got to pull up Kyrie's film, bro. Because okay. I go back and forth with this every day.
I say yes. He's the most skilled player in the entire league. Why? He can finish both hands at the rim. He can outhandle anybody in the league. He can turn over both shoulders on a fadeaway. He can step back both directions. He has a floater with both hands. He has a mid-range pull-up. He's got the three ball off the catch and off the bounce.
I think let's just watch it in its entirety, bro.
What's he missing?
Nothing. He just doesn't go up and windmill on you, I guess. I don't know. Like, he's hella good, bro. But Marcellus was on yesterday. He said Kyrie is the most skilled player ever.
Who's the most skilled player if he's not?
So you would agree with that?
Just tell me who it is if it's not him.
I don't know. Maybe I don't know. Wait.
I don't know anybody who could do all those things.
Like, okay, ever. So who's on that list then? Because, all right, that's what I was going to say. Kobe's definitely on that list. People don't realize how good Kobe's handle was.
Sorry, I forgot footwork. Footwork off the charts for both of them.
I think it's like, for me, that's like, I don't know who else is on the list.
Kyrie, Kobe. CP is close.
No, CP3 is not more. All right. No. All right.
He
so,
does a lot, though. What does he not do?
Okay,
the only thing
so.
He doesn't like turnovers, right shoulder. That's it.
So let me correct that. All right, let's go over everything. Isolation.
Okay.
Right? I think Kyrie got the edge in that. Pick and roll.
You're talking Chris about Kyrie
Paul,
versus who?
CP3. CP3 has the edge in that and pick and roll. Easy, right?
IQ. But he's...
IQ, yeah.
Yeah.
So, like, as in... But as in finishing... We can go down the list on all that type of stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
But as in finishing...
Kyrie.
Shooting...
CP. Or Kyrie. I don't know. That's tough.
That's tough because I think Kyrie shoots the better from the long ball better.
Yeah,
I think I would trust... I would trust Kyrie to shoot the long ball better, but I would trust CP3 off a screen, mid-range at the elbow. Nasty.
Going to the right elbow.
Who does this right now? Like nasty.
He made that?
Yeah, he made that, bro. Like, look at it fast.
That's disgusting. But people are saying Harden, but Harden has no post moves. So, like, going down that checklist.
And Kyrie has better post moves than Harden, 100%.
Yes. People are saying Booker, but his handle's not the same.
Booker can't dribble like Curry. Who shoots? Because Booker's very accurate.
Yeah.
Who passes better out of Booker and Curry?
Who passes better?
Yeah.
Booker played some point guard for some time. You know what I'd like to look at is potential assists.
Okay.
They have that stat on Synergy, don't they?
I don't know. We're let me look it up. Potential.
I think the assist is one of the worst stats in all of basketball.
Okay, where can I find it?
Potential assist? I think it's just under like passes.
Got me. Can you see it?
Say it again.
Can you see it?
It's all blurry, but I think it's under passes somewhere. I can like see it, but I can't see it.
All right, we'll just skip out on that one for a second. But I don't know, bro. I don't know. I don't think that anybody from footwork to finishing, like crafty finishing to shooting, to like a lot of stuff. Like, I just don't think that anybody. All right, so let me ask you a question. I'm being a devil's advocate right now.
Okay.
Would we say that if he didn't cross as many people?
Who?
Kyrie. Would we say that he's the most skilled ever if he didn't cross as many people?
If he's still able to get to his spots, I guess, but then that would kind of take the handle out of the equation.
Why?
Because you could say that like a dude like Kobe or Michael Jordan's handle is not as good as Kyrie, but they can get to their spots. But when you're just looking at overall skill, like, yeah, they can still get there, but Kyrie's skill of his handle is better.
Okay.
Right? Like, Luka can get wherever he wants to. His handle's not bad, but it's not nearly at the level of these guys.
So why isn't a player – I'm just throwing stuff at you right now.
Yeah.
Why isn't a player like Curry – in this category?
I'd say he's close, but if you look at the list.
This is right? doodoo.com right here.
What? What do you say?
This is terrible. Okay. All right, close, so but you, so you Steph could list. Hold on, Steph could definitely shoot better. But yes. Curry could really finish, bro. Like really finish. What?
He's really up there, tough. He just doesn't have the post up and his mid range is not the same.
No, I definitely don't know how to post up.
So just overall skill set. And Curry's footwork is nice. It's just different footwork.
Who's better, CP3 or Kyrie in the post?
In the post? I'll take Kyrie because, you know, CP3 wants to play over that left shoulder.
All right. Like, who? Yeah, it's tough. But... it's very clear that a guy like Kyrie 101 in isolation game is clearly better than guys like Steph, in my opinion. I feel like Kyrie can get a bucket better 101 more consistently and more fluid than a guy like Steph. And I'm a Steph guy. I just want everybody to know that. I like Steph way more than I like Kyrie. Kyrie's like my third favorite point guard.
But I agree, though.
In a one-on-one situation, you know, Kyrie is just – he might be one of the best – now, I wouldn't say the best ISO players of all time, but, you know, obviously his handle gets him to wherever he wants to go. They're saying Allen Iverson, but personally, I don't believe Iverson's finishing package was to this level. There aren't many guys that finish right and left quite as good as Kyrie or Steph.
Curry.
Steph is excellent with his left hand.
People sleep on his finishing.
It's really good. I'm telling you, it's really good. But Kyrie, those hanging finishes are too much, bro. From floaters to runners to left hand. Like, if you just go on YouTube after this is over, go on YouTube and type type left-handed finishes. Kyrie left-handed finishes. It's incredible.
Beautiful.
Like, it's incredible. Like, he shot one from the free throw line with his left, like a floater. Like it was no problem. And did it in stride.
Who in the league has an offhand floater? Not that you got to teach it that well, but who has one like Kyrie? Mike Conley might be the only one.
Mike Conley, his little floater package is crazy.
He only does right-hand floaters.
Steph has those scoop layups with his left hand, and he has outside finishes with his left hand. But in terms of the runners, I think, I mean, Kyrie might be the only one, in my opinion. Like, the he's the best one for sure.
Yeah. Steph's underhand scoop is crazy, though.
And he did it more. He did it a lot more, like, a couple of years ago. I haven't seen it as much lately, but.
Yeah. Someone said Tony Parker, but I don't think he ever used his left.
I don't have I don't have that many clips of Tony Parker using his left hand at all.
I don't think it exists.
Him, Ginobili, and wait, hold on for a second. Him, Ginobili, and Duncan. Hold on, let me open the door for this guy real quick. Hold on.
Go for it. Is it him, Ginobili, and Duncan? Yeah, Duncan probably never used his left hand either. Karl-Anthony Towns underrated? He is. The Wolves will get some love, though. The Wolves will get some love. Anthony Edwards. Okay, who do y'all have as your rookie of the year so far? Because I know some of my favorite guys. And this might be one of the best rookie classes. Let's see. Malcolm Brogdon. That was a huge loss for the Bucks. Hey, yo, Dev, who you got as your rookie of the year?
Who do I have as my rookie of the year?
Yes, sir.
LaMelo's up there.
Okay.
Halliburton is up there.
Oh my God, his shot kills me.
It kills me too. But you know what's funny? What's funny about him is people were saying that. He was talking. He had posted on Twitter like, "Yo, everybody said that my shot wouldn't work in the NBA, but you know, because he was hitting like game winners pretty much."
Yeah.
So like it seemed like he set on it too, which is crazy to me.
Oh, he's gonna keep it that way.
I don't like his shot at all. Wiseman is up there, but for me, he's not the rookie of the year. But he's been playing really good lately. Peyton Pritchard is up there. Mm-hmm. Maxey had a really good game. Like, yep. He had like 36 or something one game. 38.
I think he had like a 40 ball almost when Simmons was out.
We got
Anthony Edwards.
Our oops, Merge. We sent it out a while back. These are our new ones that we're going to send some more out right now.
And so how are you giving away the Saitama shirt?
Huh?
How are you going to give away the Saitama shirt? How are they going to win it?
How should we give it away?
Oh, that's tough.
It got to be a question in here, like some type of trivia. It's got to be
some sort of basketball IQ of some sort.
Okay. All right. Interesting.
You know what you got to ask him is who's the best, you know what I'm saying? Like between Nikola Pekovic and Vucevic and Stojakovic and Marjanovic.
Jokic.
Jokic. Like, who's the best bitch?
Who's the best bitch? But it's all subjective, though.
I live for that.
the best bitch. I never even thought about that. I don't think about that until I hear Shaq talk about it.
Vucevic is killing right now.
All right, hold on. All right, so real quick. We're going to give away this shirt right here. So there has to be... Oh, this is the end of last show we sampled a while back. But there has to be a way. Okay, they can text my number.
There you go.
Let's see. All right. So what's the trivia? We got to do some sort of like. This is a very important shirt to me. You know how long I've been waiting for the next season to come out?
Season 2 already came out.
The other part to it. They're making 2 parts.
Oh, shoot. I didn't know.
All right, give me like some historical something. All right, so the best. So we're talking about bitches, right? Give me one, the first to text like which bitch plays for which team, like a throwback bitch. I need a throwback bitch.
That's hilarious. Okay, you know, I would rock with Sasha.
Sasha Vujicic, your favorite, bro?
Dude, Lakers, it's my guy.
All right, so let's do this. Let's do this. If you could tell me...
Who was the first bitch to play in the league?
Do you know that?
No, I don't.
We should look it up. How can we do this? What should we do? Marjanovic?
So it said Marjanovic.
Doncic?
Petrovic.
V-I-C. Nah, somebody thought.
All right, how can we do it? Vlade Divac. That doesn't count. It's close.
That doesn't count. Where's the bitch? Let's see. All right. I'll do something easy. Let's do this. If you text, bro, this was.
Hold on. What is it?
This was nasty, bro. Like, just the. I'm all for the inside hand finishes movement, but just to see him do this stuff in a game live like this is incredible to me. Because I work on it and I could do all this, but like for me to apply it in the game, it's like so much harder for me to do. Like, you know, and I have a respect for how he does it. Like, he'll switch to the left hand and do the same thing. And did you see that one where LaMelo tried to block his shot? And he switched and spun it still.
Okay, the crazy part about that is that that was the first bucket LaMelo scored in the league. The same way, drive right, switch overhand, lefty finish.
Crazy. But Kyrie spun it, though, which was nasty to me.
Oh, I didn't see that.
That was a tough one. Kyrie spun it. And so, okay, let's do this. In 2017.
Okay.
Oh, wait, no. I gotta know. Has there ever been a Vitch to win a three-point contest?
Did Sasha compete?
I don't know.
Did Stojakovic compete?
I'm sorry. I don't know.
I can't tell you.
you maybe want to come up with a trivia question for the Vitches, but I can't think of anything.
I need one. People are saying Maravich, and they're all there. Hmm. Someone said Goku itch.
All right. I'll do this. Text me right now, 310-359-0521.
Say it again, and I'll put it in the chat.
310-359-0521. And you have to tell me this. This is easy. Very easy. Text me what college Kyrie went to right now.
Oh, that's too easy.
If you want the shirt. Is it too easy? All right, no. Never mind.
Too easy. That's too easy.
Okay.
Give him a different one. Give him like Duncan Robinson.
Nah. Text me right now.
Go back. You got to go back to that clip, though.
All right, let me see.
This is insane. Watch his footwork on this. So he goes perfect right left, but watch how, like, the left foot, and, like, watch his balance with it. Okay, first of all, you see the offhand, and then the right foot goes in, and the left foot goes out. That right there is some amazing control to sell your drive with one foot going forward, but the other foot going out to get your balance to shoot the shot.
So do you teach that, how he did it?
Only to really advanced players.
This is what I teach on the pull-up. When you're going full speed, you need to have this left foot that Kyrie has down a little bit wider. And the reason why, because it stops your momentum from continuing left. Kind of like almost like a kickstand, if you think about that, for lack of a better analogy. But the right foot slows you down, the left foot stops you. That's what I'll try to focus on in terms of with pull-ups. Same thing to the right. And you'll see that with a lot of players, it's normally that that left foot is a little bit wider on a full speed stop right there into a jumper. Now, you could even still see at the same time, his momentum still carried him left. And this is like, for me, it's so important, slightly left, it was barely though. But for me, it's so important to really focus on guys' leg strength, and, you know, building up, your hips and everything so that you can stop and be able to pop into shots right here and be able to rise. Now, you have something, let's see. We had talked about something the other day. So you can see it a little bit right there. That's not, he's not straight up and down. He's stopping himself a little bit more with that right leg. The left leg slowed him down.
Huge left foot step. A beautiful pop.
Yep. Now, we had talked about something the other day. Lower release versus higher release. The good and the bad. And so you think that it's good to shoot with two different ways opposed to just one different way. But at the same time, what are the advantages of having a higher release?
One, control when you're closer. And two, get it over. Because if you have a lower release, it's more of a push. Mm-hmm. So when you get closer, it's harder to control that push. So the control when you have a higher release is easier just to flick and have a soft touch. And then, of course, you get it over the defense. But when you're further, you get that lower release so you can get it to the basket. You did not make that. Goodness gracious.
I was about to say, you made that, bro. So what are the keys for you for figuring things out with this team? Kyrie, Kevin Durant, and Harden. I think it's, oh my gosh. Dang. Hold on. Everything goes back. Dang. He was mixing drumming. He was he was out of there. So what are the keys to making things like that work? You have three guys that can knock down shots and two of them proven at a very high clip. What are the keys to figuring things out? What type of offense would you like to run with a team like this?
Steve Nash is the key. He needs to get his rotations perfect. But obviously a guy like what's his name? Joey. Shooter. What's his name?
Joe Harris?
Thank you. Joe Harris. Yes. He's probably going to have to play more minutes than anybody just to space that floor the right way. But as far as offense that I would run with these guys, I'd definitely get KD some hype. So I'd run some horns probably. Okay. Get KD at the high post.
Who else?
You get Harden coming off pick and rolls. And that way he gets to play a two-man game with him. Or you get Kyrie playing two-man game, and you can put Harden on the wing. Maybe have him come off. Kyrie comes off more Iverson cuts. And then you might see James coming off pin, like wide pin downs.
I got an easy one. But you have to look it up. So if you don't know it off top, then you'll be able, you won't get it. If you want this, say Thomas shirt. Hold on, let me tell you the size before you get something that fits you like a blanket. It doesn't say. It was a sample. It didn't even say. All right, it fits me. It's a large for sure. All right, this shirt is a large. So if you want this shirt, you want to say Thomas shirt, I'll show it to you real quick. Go back real quick.
Hey, Dev.
So if you're looking.
Go ahead. Do the shirt thing.
All right, so if you're looking for this Say Thomas in the Lab shirt, I want you to text Kyrie and then tell me what his career high is in basketball. Like, since he's been what's his career high? So first person to do that wins the shirt. So the number is 310-359-0521. Text Kyrie and then text the number that's his career high. Do you know off top what his career high is?
My guess is 63.
Let's look. Let's ask. What's Kyrie's career high? Of course she would do that. Never mind.
She took me to Safari.
Yeah, took me to a link. Irving, career high. I want to say it's like, I don't know if he got to 60.
57.
It's 57?
Yeah.
For sure?
I thought he had at least 60.
Oh, yeah, 57. Are you surprised that he hasn't scored 60 yet?
Yes, because Harden's done it too many times.
You know what's funny? So my argument was going to be that I was going to say that he dribbles more and doesn't, like, shoot fast enough. Somebody like Clay, he ran 60 and, like, so fast because he barely dribbling the ball. So he has so much time to do it. But if Harden did it, then that would, like, defeat my whole thing. Like,
yeah.
Because Harden's, I mean, what's his career high? I can't remember. He has, like, 60-something, right?
Also 60-something, yeah. I think he could have probably beat Kobe a few times.
Wait, he had it a few times last year, bro, if I'm not mistaken.
He probably had some 60 balls in three quarters.
Do you remember when Kobe had 63 against Dallas?
In three quarters, and they had 62.
And I really wanted him to play that fourth. I never forget that. And then not too long after, I believe he had that, what, 81, 82, 81?
Yeah. James is 61.
James, I thought it was more than that. It was 61?
That's what it says here.
That's hella points, bro.
Yeah, that's insane. How about, what's his name? Jimmer Fredette having a 70 ball. And then the dude he played against had 68.
Oh, hey, so who was the guy that scored? Doggone it, what was his name? So I was watching that footage, and it was kind of crazy, actually.
For Jimmer?
Huh?
You're going to pull up Jimmer?
Find out what team he plays for right now.
Jimmer for that team. Okay, I got you.
He plays Jimmer. For. Somebody tell me what team Jimmer for that plays for. NBA.
Shanghai Sharks.
Oh, yeah. Sure. When I was over there, he was still playing with Shanghai Sharks, China. No, league.
Imagine dropping 68 and your plus minus is negative two.
Shanghai Sharks. Wait, no, not FIBA national teams. It is. I look at this mess every day and I don't know why I can't. Oh, that's why. Wait, no. It shouldn't be college, man. FIBA, Summer League, NBA. Oh, international. Why was I tripping like that? All right, Shanghai Sharks.
Oh. What is the most effective move in all of basketball, Dev?
My favorite move is, I call it Harden, but it's a cross jab.
Cross jab. I think the pump fake is the best move in all basketball.
Well, because you don't waste anything. Somebody asked me that the other day. We're talking about the pump fake. And it's like, you don't waste anything.
Yeah, I think a shot fake in general is just the best move in basketball.
Well, especially like off a closeout, too. There he is.
Well, the reason I say that is because whether it's a hezzy or whether it's a pump fake, that's the only move where someone would jump. Versus any other move, you got to make a move right to left.
Let's see. When do you use pump fakes more, in a one-on-one or in a live game?
I mean, you're probably using more in ones because you just get more touches.
Jimmer Fredette's somebody that uses a lot of legs and gets up really high and can shoot it from that. Do you remember how good he was at BYU? He was so good, bro. Talk about how is he able to get, you know, that much, you know, lift into a shot and still be able to knock it down from deep.
It's beautiful. I watched him play live against, I want to say, Kawhi Leonard.
Oh, yeah. They were in college the same time, weren't they?
Mm-hmm. And that's when Jimmer range was a thing, but no one talks about that no more.
We did used to say Jimmer range. You're right about that.
It wasn't Dame. It wasn't Steph.
It was Jimmer range. Dang, that's a really good point. I forgot about that. And then, you know, that's what happens when you're not in the league anymore.
Crazy.
Dang. How many other things do we think about like that? That happened like that? Oh, he got that off quick.
Super fast.
All right, let's look at where he's shooting.
That's high, keep high.
I heard Duncan Robinson saying that. Talk about his jumper.
He actually shoots with two hands.
Yeah, you can see it right there. His left hand releases it too.
Yeah.
So he's thumbing the ball, right?
Oh, yeah. But he has good rotation on it, so it matters less than someone like Joakim Noah who thumbs in has bad rotation.
Bro, I'm like tripping out that we did. It was Jimmer range before it was Steph range. That's our Dame range.
Yeah.
Wow.
Logo Lillard was Jimmer range.
That was when he was going nuts in BYU. Then he airballed.
And the college line was actually closer. All right, go back. So, not even just the shot. This is one of my favorite actions for shooters, and you see like Duncan Robinson do this a lot. Go a little more back. But if you're a shooter, you have to have this. So whether it's an offensive rebound or not, you see Jimmer just kind of chilling, walking to the free throw line,
yeah,
and then just sprints his ass over to the ball and just goes behind it, uses it as a screen. So he's here, just sprinting behind it, catch, shoot. If you got a quick enough shot to get that off, you need that.
So what kind of shot would you suggest in that situation? Me personally, I prefer a more of a two motion.
Personally, two motion. He shot two motion, but
in that situation,
because he's running so far away, So he had to rebalance himself. But mm-hmm. that's how his jumper is, right? You just said he has a high, or he jumps super high, he elevates high on it.
He gets high on the shot, for sure.
Yeah, but if you set your feet and your momentum is not carrying you, then you can shoot it off one motion.
Well, look at how this fool goes full speed. Look, that's what I'm noticing. I kind of forgot like how Jimmer Fredette plays, but now it's all coming back to me. He's going full speed and jump straight into the air.
There's that one dribble, four steps.
He kind of slows up, chops his feet a little bit.
Yeah.
He does shoot heavily with his left hand. It's quick, too.
That elevation is crazy.
And that's more like to the right side of his face, right?
I'd say it's with his right ear.
Yeah, it's outside a bit for sure.
I like – my favorite is obviously right eye. I'm cool with players shooting above the nose.
Right eye.
And, like, left eye, I don't like it, but I'll let it slide.
What do you mean above the nose?
So, like, if I'm right-handed, mm-hmm. I like having the ball right above my right eye. And then if you're here above the nose, like yours is more,
hold on, let me
I'm
see.
Cool with that. But once you start moving,
you're saying in terms of like the hand above the nose, like the placement of the ball.
Yes, yes, yes.
Ah, okay, got it.
I'm all day right hand above right eye.
Yeah. So I never teach above the nose. Actually I did before, but I prefer like right eye above the right eye.
Yeah. But you shoot at the forehead. Yeah, like above the nose.
I'm not changing that. It's too late.
Yeah, but I wouldn't say that's terrible.
Yeah, no, it works for me. I've been shooting the heck out the ball, but I understand because I would rather teach like the flexibility. So like me personally, all right, I'll put it to you like this. So I was learning how to play the guitar, and I connected this to basketball, which is crazy. But it had you do all these like finger exercises. You bring this one back, bring this one back, bring this one back, whatever. You go here, and then you do the same thing this way. It was kind of to build the flexibility that you need. Because like when I first started doing this, all this was cramping up. And you can feel that when you're bringing your hand. You're starting to get where I'm going with it, right?
Yeah.
And so like those finger exercises started to help build the flexibility for players that I was teaching to shoot like right here. You know, on the right side, more so the right eye, I should say, instead of like back here, because like here, you know, I hold the ball still with my thumb. I'm pretty much palming the ball almost. You know, I don't really use too much fingertips in my whole hand, but I'm pretty much palming it. And so like instead of it being like this, so I know that it could be better if I really focus on it more so being right here. Opposed to being right here, but it's still there's a lot of players that do this anyways, like keep it in the middle of their face, mm-hmm. you know, so our left side, but it just worked for me, and I felt really comfortable. And what I found out is that when I bring the ball up the middle and I have my elbows out, that it was harder to strip because it stays close to my body. I don't know when I like figured that out, but I was like, oh shoot, like that's why people haven't been stripping me. And so, you know, when I was doing it like more under, I was, you know, getting stripped a little bit more. So, but I was shooting better from catch and shoot when I was right eye. So yeah. I was like, you know what? Like all I'm doing is playing one-on-one anyway. I'm going to just keep this jumper. So that's kind of why I started doing the whole elbows out thing, which, you know, just have some back context.
What's your wrist flexibility like?
Bad. I don't have to, because the reason why I don't have to. I'll show you. It's really bad.
Yeah, I was going to say, you can't even turn your wrist to face me, can you?
So, like this? Yeah, it's really bad.
Yeah, it is.
If I did this long enough, it would cramp up. Because, like, I'm pretty much shooting like this. But, all right, so anybody inside the academy, you guys know, like, I'm teaching to get that, like, get under the ball. Like, you have to be able to be flexible and stretch your fingers out and all that type of stuff. And I started working with it. You met him, Jeremy. So, Jeremy, he's like a guy, like, all right, you're going to learn how to shoot. And he caught it really fast, but that was the main thing that started helping him when he started getting under the ball and be able to just, like, hold the ball like this, kind of like that pizza. And so, when he started doing that, his shot started instantly turning around because now – he's also stronger and like going right here. You know, for me, I get my strength almost from shooting from both hands, and I guide it up with my left hand. So, you know, just some weird little context, but and I have random thoughts about this type of stuff all the time. But you know, if I'm teaching basketball, I'm teaching it like a lot differently than I actually should.
Oh yeah. When you come to San Diego, which you finally will one day, We'll shoot some for the academy, and we'll do a whole shooting lesson for him.
All right, sir. We'll link it up for sure. Definitely some things that I want to talk to you about after this, but we've been streaming for a minute. Gonna take off here, man. I just want to give a big thanks to Ryan, man, for pulling up. You know, just, and honestly, like, Ryan, just for being such a good guy, like, you know, you've taken a lot of crap from me. I know I'm a little MF-er to deal on the basketball court, but the thing is, like, I mess with Ryan, and like, even when I used to get beat by people on one-on-one, I mess with it because I don't really trip. Like, you know, if I lose, if I take an L, it's like, whatever. Like, you know, like, we could still go do some, have pizza or go watch some anime after. That's like my thing with me and Ryan. We just chill, bro. Like, you know, Ryan's always been like, you know, that cool guy. Afterwards, it's like nothing even happened, you know. But he's definitely a fierce competitor, which I love. But at the end of the day, man, your work that you're doing with basketball is not going to go unappreciated. And I'm going to make sure of that because, you know, as much as you're growing yourself, I always have good things to say about you. When everybody asks me, I always got good things to say about you. I want you to continue to doing the work that you're doing and, you know, just really proud to see how far you came, man.
No, I appreciate it. Thank you so much. It means a lot.
So you're gonna be legendary, man. You're gonna leave a mark on this world. And the good thing about it is that you're so young. So, anyways, man, thank you guys for tuning in. Anything you want to leave everybody with, Ryan?
Ooh. Okay. Last thing. Obviously, when it comes to shooting, pretty much the only advice and the only drill that I have to do or say is just do form shots every single day. If you shoot with good form or decent form and you do form shots every single day, you'll be all right.
I'll actually piggyback on that. So if you guys have been keeping up on me on Instagram, you know those inside hand finishes? I call them wall crawlers. So like everybody asked me all these secrets, and realistically, all I did was just go underneath a basket and just work on spinning. Right hand, left hand, right hand, right hand, left hand. All right, 100, 200, 300, and I just leave. No, that's all I was doing. It wasn't really like too much. And then I would kind of add things. I learned how to spin the ball, like those little CP3, fake passes. Yeah, and then that was it. Like, it wasn't really too much. And when I started getting good at it, I started adding a little different variations to the miking where I jump and hang. All this stuff I go over with on the academy. But it really wasn't like, you know, and then so when I became a better shooter, like when I played, I always tell people this. When I played, I couldn't shoot nearly as good as I can now. And so, like, all it was is exactly what Ryan said. Underneath the basket, form shooter. Is it going in? Is it dropping in the basket? Okay, how do I feel? Rotation? Okay, cool. Does it feel normal? Am I having to throw the ball? Okay, let me move back. All right, cool. Let me get a bunch of, okay, let me move back. Bunch of shots right there. That's all. Am I lying? Like, it's not hard to do.
Bro, it's crazy. We I'm sure we both get these questions every single day where a kid says, oh, well, how do I improve my left hand? Use your left hand, bro.
just use your left hand. It's so easy. Everybody can do it.
Yeah. So all that stuff, handles, passing, do it every day. You get better. Sick. And it helps to study, watch film like this.
It absolutely does help to watch film. Even if you don't listen to a word I say, at least you could just be able to see and look at what's going on the basketball court and be able to pick some stuff up. And I guarantee you guys this, who's everybody in here is in on the chat. If you just stay strong with all this stuff and you keep looking at it and you keep showing up at 12 o'clock Monday through Friday and learning from the guys that I'm putting in front of you or the footage that I'm putting in front of you, you're going to be a better basketball player. You're going to be a better teacher. Period. There's no way you could look at this much basketball. Never mind. I'm not even gonna say what I was gonna say, but just keep looking. Just keep watching basketball. You know, it's nothing that I'm doing makes me a genius. It really doesn't. You know, I just watch it and I work hard at it.
Anything hey, let's do. Sorry to cut you off. Let's do this next week. I'll get another laptop for you, and let's break down a ton of pick and roll stuff, or let's break down some sets for him.
Cool. That works for me.
Yeah.
We'll see you guys next week with Ryan. Stay tuned. Monday through Friday, 12 o'clock noon. We always run our Twitch sessions. But I want to thank all you guys for pulling up on the way out. Just make sure to leave a thumbs up. and make sure to follow or subscribe. Ryan, where can they find you on Instagram
and YouTube? R2Bball everywhere.
R2Bball, easy as that. So just make sure that you guys keep up with everything he's doing and keep up with his YouTube videos and all that type of stuff, man. He's got a lot of good things going. And, yeah, can't wait to look forward to the future collabs, man. I'll talk.